डियर पार्टिसिपेंट्स, अगेन वेलकम बैक टू द थर्ड सेशन ऑफ द डे टू. नाउ वी हैव अगेन विद अस मिस अमरदेव, सॉरी अमनदीप कौर, हु इज एक्चुअली अगेन विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट द वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ ब्लेंडेड लर्निंग. यू शुड अंडरस्टैंड द वेरियस मॉडल्स ऑफ ब्लेंडेड लर्निंग एंड इट इज नॉट दैट द सेम मॉडल विल वर्क फॉर यू. You should know the different models and you should think which model will suit for your institution or your students or your subject. So therefore, it is necessary to understand the different models of blended learning, how to actually use them, and what all these things you should understand. So now we have with us Ms. Amandeep Kaur, who will be actually explaining you the different models of blended learning. Madam, it is over to you.
Thank you very much, sir. So, dear participants, I hope my PPT is visible to you all.
Right now, no, madam. You have not yet shared. You are in the YouTube only. Sorry, you are in the Google Meet only.
हेलो,
हाँ मैडम,
इज इट विजिबल नाउ सर?
मैडम यू आर इन मीट नाउ, जस्ट गो ऑन नाउ, इट इज विजिबल मैडम, प्लीज
ओके, थैंक यू वेरी
कैरी
मच
ऑन.
सर. सो गुड आफ्टरनून वंस अगेन ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स. एज सर इन्फॉर्म टू ऑल ऑफ यू दैट इन दिस पर्टिकुलर सेशन वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट व्हाट वी मीन बाय ब्लेंडेड लर्निंग एंड व्हाई देर इज अ डिमांड फॉर ब्लेंडेड लर्निंग. And in the last 30 minutes of this particular session, we come to know that what are the different models available to all of us to use in our teaching learning practices if we want to create a blended kind of experiences for our learners. So, as the name suggests, blended learning means it's a mixture of or integration of face-to-face learning with technology. But the concept of blended learning is far beyond that. So it is not like that you introduce a YouTube video in your class or you show any kind of demonstration to your students or the use of any audio clip in your class. It means you have created a blended classroom for your student. That is not true. When we said face-to-face teaching as well as integration of technology, so as a teacher, I need to plan. The planning need to be started from my course itself. So, started from the course itself up to the lesson plan, I need to evaluate many things available at my institute level as a faculty and even the kind of students we have at our institute level. Accordingly, I need to design what kind of blended experience it is possible for me to create for my student. As sir said that maybe one model is appropriate for your students at your institute, but maybe that model is not applicable for the students who are studying in NITR Chandigarh. So depending upon the diversity of institutions, the kind of resources we have, we need to select an appropriate model. So as far as this blended learning is concerned, it is being said that you can lead a horse to water, but you cannot make him drink. So in our traditional classrooms, what we do, in our traditional setup, when a teacher enter into a class, the teacher have a specific agenda in his or her mind. According to that specific agenda, many of us nowadays are in the process of writing learning outcomes. And then when it comes to evaluating those writing learning outcomes, we come to know that many of the students are not able to achieve those learning outcomes. We force those students to sit into a class. But those students are not willing to learn. It means maybe my student demands something else from me. My student demands a different kind of instructional approach. So I need to evaluate at my own end as a faculty that what is there that affect the process of learning in my classroom. Maybe there are behavioral issues with my student. Maybe my student want to study each and everything with the help of technology only. And I'm introducing new kind of information without knowing their level of understanding. So another thing that we need to consider is universities are new now making use of ICT. It is not just because of pandemic. Before that also, the rate of use of technology increased manifold as far as different educational institutes are concerned. And many of the institutions also uses blended approaches to deliver the course content. But when it comes to introducing any new pedagogy, it is not only blended or a flipped approach. At institute level, whenever we are introducing any new instructional method, any new technology for education, any new approach for education, at institute level, we need to think about, specifically the management and your head of department need to think about and evaluate what kind of resources we have at institute level. Another important thing that we need to consider when it comes to designing a advanced pedagogy related courses or classes at institute level, is it possible for my faculty to blend all kind of resources that are available at institute? And if at all the resources are not available, what will be our approach? If you have all kind of resources, your faculty is trained enough to blend those resources and you have link with the industry or link with another academic institution from where you can buy or borrow resources. Institute level, we need also to evaluate after using all these resources, after blending the traditional or other kind of approaches in our classroom activities, what effect or impact these techniques have on our students. So if our students are performing very well after the use of this technology, it means the institute need to go ahead with. But if at all the student consider it as a gamification or they considered it as the virtual kind of experience only, these kind of things do not have any kind of impact on their learning, the institute need to reevaluate the whole process. So buying resources or integrating bits and pieces the technology, or even by creating the attractive spaces or huge buildings, the university and or institute cannot automatically assume that your students and faculty want to adopt it. I am again saying this, if you have all kind of resources, if the institute have capability to buy all kind of resources, and we force our faculty to use these resources, we need not to be automatically assumed that our students and faculty members are ready to adopt all these kind of resources. Even if at university, the administration adopt the new innovation, it cannot be assumed that the faculty and student want to use it. So as a faculty, if my management compel me or force me that I have to use different pedagogical approaches in my day-to-day teaching, and I am also capable to perform these techniques or these pedagogical approaches in my classroom, all these things we need to consider. So we need to determine that whether the increased use and availability of online teaching resources make an impact on student achievement or not. And whenever we are integrating technology, what kind of technology we are integrating. Accessibility of technology at the part of student is there or not. So in education, where we are heading right now, as per the new education policy 2020, chapter number 19, the chapter number 19 clearly indicated that students at various educational institutions nowadays demanded that there must be integration of technology it is not only applicable to higher education. Started from a primary education, they said, there is a demand of the stakeholders that we need to integrate technology in our education. Technology is not only for the students, but it is also providing support to the teachers for their preparation and development. So as a teacher, when any new lecture come to me, what I do, I just search on internet, I identify different references. After identifying n number of resources, I evaluate those resources and then come to the conclusion, what are the different resources that are valid and how I'm going to structure that information. So with the help of this technology only, it is possible for me to prepare a new lecture. It helped me to develop professionally. It improved teaching, learning, and evaluation process. As AICT introduced a flexible MOOC policy for the students, where they are able to earn credit flexibly by using different platforms, either NAPTEL or SWAYAM, students have chances to listen from the experts of that particular area. The student sitting at my institute, maybe that student is referring to the YouTube recorded lecture at MIT University. So there are opportunities provided to the student that they can collect information, they understand information from the different resources. Exposure is maximum. So it improves teaching and learning activities. And when we are able to integrate technology in our evaluation purpose, it is possible for me to conduct a quiz right now because accessibility of technology is available with me. I know many platforms by the use of which it is possible for me to design a quiz and then give it to my participants. And in a moment of time, it is possible for me to have an evaluation also. So for formative assessment, it is very much easy for a faculty nowadays to use different platforms. As far as evaluation is concerned, so technology helps us to improve our evaluation processes also. It enhances educational access to disadvantaged group and streamline education planning, administration and management. So from this particular policy, chapter number 19, it is very much clear to all of us that there is a demand of technology, not from the authorities, not only from your institute management, but the student nowadays, whom we consider digital native generation, these students are more comfortable with the help of technology rather than using pen and paper again. So in the time to come, there are possibilities that degree can be earned without going to that institute, because all kind of facilities provided to the candidates online. So it's all flexible, no spoon feeding of information is required. Say for example, there is one subject that is a communication skill is being introduced to all the engineering graduates in their first semester. So one student is not much comfortable with the faculty of communication skills. In this particular case, the student can simply assess to the different courses of communication skill available on different platforms. There is a course on NAPTEL, there is a course on SWAYAM. So number of courses are available for the student. So student can assess that kind of information that is more advanced by nature and that cover all kind of aspects that is required by a student. So in this particular scenario, there is no spoon feeding of information is required because the abundance of resources are available not only with the students but also with the teacher. So that is why there is a demand of different kind of learning aspects. The major factors that we need to consider that in education where we are heading right now, the first thing that we all need to consider is the context of teaching is going to be changed. So earlier, before this COVID-19 situation, many of us teach in a physical classroom setup only. There are a few institution or few faculty members who are very much comfortable when it comes to teaching online to the student. It means in education, the context of teaching is going to be changed. It is not only the physical classrooms where we are supposed to teach. We need to teach to our remote students also. We need to teach to this group of students who are available on any platform. say for example, it is possible for me to teach to 50 students on a Google Meet. In WebEx meeting, it is possible for me to teach 1,000 students. It means when I'm teaching in a physical classroom where maybe 40, 60 or maybe 80 students are available with me, my teaching approach is altogether different when I am teaching students who are sitting in a remote location, the students who are available with me on an online platform. So context of teaching is going to be changed. Another important thing that as an educationist we need to consider is we need to prepare our student not only for the word of work, but we need to develop such kind of skills among my student in the time to come. They must act as a global thinker. So a bigger picture need to be visualized by a student whosoever is sitting into my class. How it is possible? Maybe the resources are not available at my institute. With the integration of technology only, it is possible for me to provide experiences to my students that are not available with me. In engineering, augmented reality, virtual realities are comparatively new concept because much of the literature till date is not developed and designed, but that kind of experiences, say virtual laboratories are in nowadays, many of the institutions are working on virtual laboratories also. So these kind of facility help us to create experiences that are not possible for me to create in a physical classroom. And at the same time, my student know the kind of advances happen in the surrounding environment. So their thinking is going to be developed. Another important thing that we need to consider is specifically in an educational institution that we need to consider the creative ability of our students also. Maybe when I'm studying at my institute, for me, whatever my teacher is saying to me, whatever my faculty is teaching to me, that is the final word and I go by his or her word. But nowadays, when my student is able to assess information in my classroom by the use of his or her smartphone only, so in that particular case, my student can ask me a question. My student said to me that I already know this information. This information is already available on XYZ website. What is new with you? Please tell me that kind of a content. It means the context of teaching is going to be changed. We need to develop our students as global thinkers. We need to take risk in our education also. At the same time, when we said today generation is very much comfortable when it comes to working in a laboratory environment instead of their theoretical classroom. The one reason may be the teacher, whosoever is engaging their practical classes, provide them opportunities to work in group. In laboratory environments, the students can interact with each other, the student collaborate with each other, they cooperate with each other, means there is a social kind of interactions that are happening in that environment. And most of the students are comfortable with that only. In that particular situation, the student, the faculty need to reevaluate that what are the expectations of my students from this education system. Student nowadays, student wants to work in teams, student wants to do something collaboratively. Student wants to perform small projects within the class only. As in the previous session, one participant said the session was not engaged, fully engaged for them because all the time I was delivering the talk only. So there are certain barriers also. In this particular case, when the context of teaching is going to be changed, we at institute level need to develop such kind of system where it is possible for us to cater the need of each and every individual. Maybe for this particular course, I need to design an LMS kind of facility where I put a question in a discussion form. So all the participants will participate in that particular discussion. And after the discussion, what will be the conclusion? That will be the crux of my lecture. So context of teaching is going to be changed. The demands of the learners are going to be changed accordingly. We need to consider that there is a need of integration of technology. And at the same time, we need to ponder upon all these issues and provided the kind of infrastructure that we require to design such kind of experiences for our students. So So as blended learning is not a new concept for all of us, but why we need blended learning? For that, we need to understand what we mean by synchronous and asynchronous learning. So as far as synchronous learning is concerned, in this kind of learning environment, the teacher is present at the same time as the learner. It means the faculty and students are available at the same time. So that kind of learning is considered as synchronous learning. So my first question to all the participants is, can you give any example where you think that synchronous learning is happening? Yes, any participant can reply. According to you, what are the different situations under which we consider that synchronous learning is happening? Lab. So from the definition, it is considered that in a classroom situation, the very simple answer for this question is, when we say teacher and student is available in a classroom, available at the same time, it means a physical space, that is classroom, is a space where synchronous learning is happening. Same in the case of laboratory environment also, the synchronous learning is happening. At this time, you and me, so you and all the participants are present at the same time. So you can ask question, I can interact with you as and when desired. I can even interact with the selective participant also. So in this particular platform also, what kind of learning is happening? Synchronous kind of learning is happening. So synchronous learning is not only restricted to a physical space, that is either classroom or a laboratory environment. In synchronous kind of learning, teacher can use online learning also, means teacher can sync technology, and even the students who are sitting in my class can sync technology. Say for example, you have given a very different kind of a statement to your students or a problem to your students to solve. The very first statement came from the student side is, ma'am, can we use different internet resources? Or ma'am, can we use our smartphone in a classroom situation? It means student knows that the information is available on different website. I can sync technology and able to produce answer for the statement that is being asked by the faculty. So any situation where teacher and learner is present at the same time are the platforms where synchronous learning is happening. It can be your classroom, it can be laboratory, it can be either by the use of webinars, group chats, even drop-in session, video conferencing, live chat also. These are all the things that we can do in a synchronous learning environment. Even in this particular situation, if any of the participants whosoever know my number, simply text me his question. So by seeing the message only, I'm able to reply to that participant. But when it comes to synchronous learning, there is a skill set that need to be developed at both ends. It is not only at the part of the faculty, but student also need to be equipped with some of the skills that are essential for the process of learning. So some of the skills are required as far as synchronous learning is concerned, especially if you are going to integrate technology with that. For a teacher, according to me, what I feel every time is the most difficult part at the teacher is to manage the fast pace of teaching. So that is the most difficult part for me as far as synchronous learning is concerned, because in a classroom situation, or when I'm simply using an online platform to teach to my student, I need to focus on that particular aspect only. But when I'm providing a synchronous kind of environment, I need to check the chat also. I need to interact with the participants also. At the same time, my voice audibility and my PPT need to be visible to all of you. So there are certain set of skills that need to be developed by the faculty as far as synchronous learning is concerned. So traditional classroom and even online learning platforms or any online learning environment that is being created by a faculty, where it is possible for the faculty to interact with the students, that kind of environment are very beneficial as far as synchronous learning is concerned. There are certain barriers to synchronous learning. Excuse me. The very first barrier is it limits flexibility. So basically, when it comes to a limit flexibility, as a teacher, I can deliver lecture maybe 30 minutes, 45 minutes, 50 minutes or 60 minutes. So the total command is with me only. But as far as learners are concerned, as per the definition, learner and teacher need to be there at the same time. If the learner is not available, it means it will limit the flexibility of that particular learner. Learner need to be with the teacher on this particular platform. The second is the schedule is fixed. All the students need to be work at the same pace. Say, for example, in the next 10 minutes, I'm going to give you a Google link, where a Google form link, where you have to provide input to me. After evaluating your input only, I'm going to elaborate all kind of discussions that we are in since 12 o'clock. So the learner need to respond to me within that 10 to 15 minutes of time only. That much flexibility I give to my learners. So schedule is fixed in synchronous learning, and students need to perform within the time that is being desired by the faculty. All will work on a same time. And if at all the learner is not available, he or she will miss the content. So these are certain barriers to synchronous learning. Another kind of learning that can be there at institute level is asynchronous learning. In this learning, the teacher is not present at the same time as the learner. Now my next question to all of you is, how many of you undergo the policy modules of AICT? Yes, how many of you put the policy modules, 8 modules developed by AICT? Only one participant till now replied. So thank you very much, Dr. Tirupati Ashok Power. So as far as synchronous learning is asynchronous learning is concerned, from the definition it is clear that teacher is not present at the same time as a learner. So flexibility is provided to the learner that they can manage their path, they can manage their pace of learning, and even they can plan for their schedule of learning. So flexibility is given to the candidates and teacher is not there. So in this particular case, if at all the teacher is using an online learning platform, the teacher prepare the content, the teacher will prepare the course material, and that course material will be posted by the teacher online. After getting that course material, the students in their own time work on that material. The kind of activities that have been designed by the teacher, these kind of things the student need to perform at his or her own time. In asynchronous learning, again, the course schedule can be fixed by the faculty, but in this particular case, a time is given to the student. So for example, if there is an assignment and I'm using an asynchronous learning kind of a concept, for the completion of that assignment, I will provide 3 to 5 day time to my learners. Maybe multiple times my learner can undergo that activity. As in NPTEL, the participant, the student can submit activity number of times. So that kind of flexibility can be given to the learner as far as asynchronous learning is concerned. So the number of examples are there. Asynchronous learning means maybe with the use of discussion forum, it is possible for me to create asynchronous learning. By the use of electronic boards, it is possible for me to design asynchronous kind of learning. So in asynchronous kind of learning, we include variety of media. It is not only limited to audio and video. In asynchronous learning, it is possible for me to use variety of media to create learning experiences for the candidates. So in this particular case, the teacher is present, not present at the same time as the learner. So asynchronous learning means the teacher can design many of the activities for the students online, where the teacher is creating interaction among the learners. So when I said a question is posted on discussion forum and it is a peer reviewed assignment. Peer reviewed assignment means each and every participant will provide his valuable input to the another candidate. So interactions are going to be created. The teacher, but in asynchronous learning, the content will be created by the teacher only. The candidates who undergo this particular AICT module, 8 modules, the booklet is being provided to all the candidates for 8 different modules. And to prepare one booklet for one module, it takes time of around 1.5 years. So you cannot copy paste information from the different internet resources and simply distribute it among the learners. The faculty need to develop his or her own content and in such a manner that it is easy for the student to understand that content. So when we are teaching on an online platform, when we are teaching online to our student, we do not know our students very well. There are very limited interaction. We are not able to develop good interpersonal relationship with our learners. So in this particular situation, the content need to be developed by the faculty in the most simplest form possible, so that it is easy for all the students to understand that content and undergo the activities that is being designed by the teacher. So in an asynchronous learning, most of the time we just go by online learning only and we provide information to all our students. But as far as we earlier discussed, in synchronous learning, we have to develop some sort of skills, not only among teachers, but also among the students to go through those kind of experiences. As far as asynchronous learning is concerned, the first requirement that we need to fulfill is capacity building program. Capacity building program specifically for the faculty. Nowadays, in this situation, many of the universities, institutions are forced to teach students online, and many of the universities issue guidelines to the students, direct the students that they are not allowed to record the lectures of the faculty. That is not ethical. When we are delivering lectures only for our student, my student need to have freedom that he or she can record my lecture, and as and when desired, my student can refer to that lecture. So capacity building, we need to prepare our faculty, we need to prepare our institute that when it comes to an online learning, the teacher need to develop a content, the teacher need not to be providing copy pasted links from YouTube or from NAPTEL or from SWAYAM. If you are going to use those resources, you need to provide information to the student also that from this particular link you need to undergo for this particular topic. But if at all these kind of resources is being utilized by the teacher, the evaluation strategy also need to be developed by the teacher. So there are many issues related to this asynchronous learning for which the teacher and the institute need to provide capacity building training to the faculty. Another important thing that we need to consider under asynchronous learning is infrastructure facilities. What kind of infrastructure facilities you have? The stakeholders, even the parents of your students, management. So what are the demands of these stakeholders? Even the industry. So what are the different demands of those stakeholders? According to that only I'm going to plan for my courses. Flexibility to the faculty. When I said flexibility to the faculty, so flexibility in flexibility to the faculty to work at their own pace and flexibility to the faculty to work at their own time. So when I said I'm going to engage my online class, specifically in asynchronous learning, the teacher as well as the class can decide that time which is comfortable for all of them. I'm going to plan any kind of evaluation for my student. I need to check the availability of my student in an online platform. So according to that only, I'm going to design that evaluation. If your course is of fixed schedule, you need to prepare a timeline that when you are going to give assignment to your student. Maybe after the completion of 2 units, maybe after the completion of the 3 units. So you need to plan accordingly. So such kind of flexibility needs to be with the faculty that they can work at their own pace and they can work at their own time. Another important thing to consider is the work culture. So when we said an online learning environment or online courses that have been floated to the student, online course doesn't mean 9-to-5 working. Online course means maybe my learner reading that content at night and my learner have a difficulty. My learner can post me question anytime. As a teacher, I need to structure the answer properly and then according to my own pace, according to the time available with me, I will answer to that query. So work culture is also going to be changed if there is an asynchronous learning. Generation gap, many of the senior faculty members are not comfortable with the use of technology. At institute level, a technical assistance need to be provided to those faculty members up to the extent they are not accustomed to that platform. So we need to consider this factor also. Students nowadays are able to use technology more efficiently as compared to faculty. So a technical assistant somewhere is also required at the part of the faculty to manage interaction with the students. So these are the certain barriers to asynchronous learning. So what we mean by blended learning? Blended learning is synchronous plus asynchronous learning. So by definition, in simple terms, if we talk about blended learning is an integration of face-to-face learning with an online learning. Now the question arises, when there is technology available, it is possible for me to teach with technology, why I am integrating face-to-face learning for my students? So why there is a demand of blended learning? So when it comes to blended learning, as per this slide, we said it's a combination of synchronous and asynchronous learning. There are certain barriers that are associated with synchronous learning. To avoid those barriers and to create an human interaction or personalized instruction, it is possible for me to create such kind of experiences only by the use of blended learning. As in synchronous learning, we said that teacher and student need to be available at the same time. Asynchronous learning, most of the things are happening online only, means to create a human kind of experiences for our students, human interaction for our students, personalized instruction for our student, there is a demand of blended learning. So when it comes to an online learning environment or asynchronous learning, it is very difficult for the teacher to counsel the student. It is sometimes difficult for the faculty to provide feedback to the student. In a classroom situation, there are opportunities where the teacher can provide instant feedback to the student. But on an online platform, these things are not possible. In synchronous learning, we said teacher need to be there all the time, student need to be there all the time. There is a different kind of barrier related with synchronous learning. So to remove all these issues, a blended learning approach need to be followed at institute level. So another question arises that if the solution to avoid the barriers of synchronous and asynchronous learning is blended learning, by which it is possible for me to create experiences. So how I'm going to blend it? So the next question arises, how to club synchronous and asynchronous learning? So I request the participants to kindly reply how it is possible for us to integrate synchronous and asynchronous learning. Any participant? I know many of the institutions already using blended learning. How it is possible for us to club synchronous and asynchronous learning at institute level? By flipped classes. As far as flipped classroom is concerned, flipped classroom is a model of blended learning. It is one of the model of blended learning, that is flipped classroom. In simple terms, we also say, we also consider that flipped classroom is a subset of blended learning by interactive videos. When you said video, video means it is a recorded session by the faculty. In video, by the use of different software, it is possible for the teacher to evaluate the student. Say, for example, in Edpuzzle software, it is a platform. It is possible for the teacher to assess the student by the use of different 9 types of questions. So interactive video is not a way to blend synchronous and asynchronous. LMS with offline and online interaction, okay. Assignment test by interactive classroom. One participant said, my creating teams. So when it comes to clubbing of synchronous and asynchronous learning, many of you replied flipped classroom. Flipped classroom is again a subset of blended learning where we use synchronous and asynchronous learning environment. By the use of interactive video, with the help of video, it is possible for the teacher to evaluate with the student. But live interactions are possible with the help of different platforms. It is not recorded video. It is the teacher is available online at the time when the students are asking questions. So when it comes to blend synchronous and asynchronous environment, there are certain factors that we need to consider. One is the content. So when a content means, learning material must be prepared and it must be tailor-made. When I said tailored-made, my student is able to identify different information resources on a website. My student is able to have access to different information lectures available on YouTube, NAPTEL or Swayam. But maybe that content is not easy for my student to understand. So when we said content in blended learning, that content need to be tailored made by the faculty and that kind of content need to be provided to the student. So when it comes to club synchronous and asynchronous learning, in a classroom situation also, there are many models available with us where it is possible for me to create a blended kind of experiences. But the first requirement as a faculty that I need to fulfill is the development of the content. If I'm borrowing the content of any another expert, after providing information and taking permission from that expert, I need to simplify that content according to the level of the students I have. Schedule. Second thing that we need to consider is schedule. First, the content is being prepared by the faculty and either the use of offline or online LMS facility provided to the student. And after the completion of, say, the first assignment, as a faculty, you come to know that many of the students are producing same kind of errors again and again. It means it's a time for the faculty to organize the class. Either offline, either online, where the teacher can provide direct instructions to the student that how to perform this activity, the kind of errors that have been produced by the students and how to remove those errors. So once the student go through that particular content, there is a schedule fixed by the teacher where the teacher or the faculty will interact with the student and after identifying their errors and try to remove those errors with the help of the direct instructions. That is not possible only with the help of online platform. The third important thing that we need to consider before clubbing synchronous and asynchronous learning is the kind of assessment that we are going to create for our student. So when in a blended learning classroom, specifically when the students are working online, in this particular situation, the teacher need to plan assessment for the student to know their level of understanding. If the resources are not available at your institute to plan for assessment, there are many open educational resources available with the faculty to use for free. The teacher can utilize those resources also. So whenever the teacher has a time available or the students have a certain doubts that it is not possible for them to clear at their own end, the teacher need to plan interaction with the student. So when it comes to clubbing a synchronous and asynchronous learning, the teacher need to consider that in synchronous learning, it is possible for the student to socialize with each other. So when the students in a classroom situation or when the students are available on an online platform at the same time, it is possible for them to interact with each other. So in synchronous learning, socializing is there. Sometimes the students are formally discussing with each other and there are informal discussions also. But in synchronous learning, it is possible for the teacher to provide feedback. So to give feedback to the student, it is very easy and effective too. Whereas in asynchronous learning, resources are available with the teacher and with the students. And the important thing that we need to consider in an asynchronous learning case is human interaction is missing. Feedback can be given instantly, but how the another person, how the student is reacting to that feedback, that is not known to the faculty. So either the teacher can go by a choice of a peer feedback rather than providing a direct feedback to the student, or the teacher need to take time to structure that message and then send that message to the student. So with the help of the clubbing of synchronous and asynchronous learning, it is possible for the teacher to avoid all those errors, that is, or all those barriers that is being produced by these kind of learning. And at the same time, a kind of human interaction is possible for the teacher with the help of a blended learning. So flipped classroom is a one approach by the use of which it is possible for me to create or club synchronous and asynchronous learning. That is the right answer to give to this particular statement. Another important thing is how I am going to achieve it. The first thing is teaching online. So when I said I'll go by a blended learning, I need to develop a skill of teaching online to my student. As we have earlier discussed in the previous class, there are variety of learners. Their learning styles are different. So there is a need of different kind of approach as compared to a traditional teaching practices. So when it comes to teaching online, as compared to your traditional setting, a different kind of approach is required at the part of the faculty. So both teacher and student need to develop that kind of a skill. Specifically, say for example, if your learner demand or your learner required a structured kind of information, how as a faculty you are going to make him or her comfortable? There is student who after reading the content online ask number of questions to the teacher. There are many confusions. So how the teacher is going to solve all those confusions? So the skill that need to be developed by the faculty is how to teach online. The second important thing that we need to consider is communication skill. In a blended learning classroom, when there is an integration of traditional setup, that is face-to-face teaching, along with your online learning platform, a different kind of communication skills are required. There are four major communication skills that we use in our classroom structure, that is reading, listening, writing, and speaking. As far as speaking is concerned, in an asynchronous learning, there are very minimum opportunities available with the teacher to speak. So either we speak about the content, so when we are speaking, our tone, variety in a tone, integration of technology by the use of which it is possible for me to speak to my students. So speaking, there are minimum chances available with the faculty to speak. As far as writing is concerned, one is we are writing to our student not only the content but also about their doubts, about the clarification that is required. We provide feedback to the candidates also. So whenever I am writing on a blended kind of an approach, specifically on online learning platform, I need to consider my student as an individual being. So whatever I am writing, the selection of the word, the tone of my written word need to be respectful enough for my student. So whenever we are writing for an online platform, we need to take time to construct our feedback messages. So with the help of discussion forum, it is possible for the faculty to ask the students to write something. So we are also able to involve our student in the process of writing. When it comes to writing, another thing that we need to consider is we are not available with the student specifically in an asynchronous learning, and blended is a combination of both. So when my students are working on an online platform, say one student sending me an message by the use of emoji. So on online platform, it is not possible for me to evaluate the non-verbal behavior of my student, that providing me hint, that providing me a feedback. So infographics, use of emojis need to be acceptable by me, by the students on that particular platform, because these kind of symbols, these kind of language help me to observe the non-verbal behavior of my student. So they are showing their emotion. This is again a form of writing that we need to consider in an asynchronous platform. Third kind of communication skill is listening skill. So in listening, specifically in asynchronous learning, the teacher need to consider that my voice is audible. If not audible, I may be repeat it again and again. I need to be attentive all the time, and at the same time, in case of listening also, I need to be respectful all the time for my participant, irrespective of their age. When it comes to blended kind of environment, reading is again an important component, because in blended, when the students are working online and the content is being provided by the teacher, maybe with the use of your institution LMS, when the teacher is providing content to the student, that content need to be personalized enough, that content need to be simplest enough, so that students are able to develop connection with that particular content. So maybe with the help of self-learning modules, it is possible for me to engage my students in the process of reading. Another thing that we need to consider is the kind of learning space. So when it comes to a blended learning, the first requirement is your physical classroom. Say if I'm using a station rotation model or a lab rotation model or a flex model of blended learning, in that particular situation, I need a classroom situation. I need a physical classroom where it is possible for me to provide a direct instructions to my student. But in station rotation model or in lab rotation model, when my students are working online, in that particular case, my learning space need to fulfill all these kind of facilities. So learning space requirement as far as blended learning is concerned, there is a requirement of your physical spaces or a classroom also. And there is a requirement of an isolated online spaces also. So we need to create an interactive experiences for our students with the integration of both. As a teacher, in terms of learning space, as a teacher, I also need to understand that there is a complexity of technology. say I'm using a station rotation model for my student. I'll show you that model also. It's a very simple model of blended learning. It's a station rotation model where on a fixed schedule, the student will move from their classroom to a online platform. So when I set my student, after a period of time, my student will move from a classroom to a specific location that must be online platform. So that kind of learning space facility need to be there at my institute level. So lab space is an important thing we need to consider when we are going to design our blended kind of experience for our students. So learning space we need to consider. Another important thing that we need to consider is in terms of learning space, specifically when the students are using technology, as an expert, either there is a requirement of a technical assistant. If technical assistance is not provided to the student, in that particular case, the teacher need to become an expert of that technology also. The teacher will guide the student how to use that technology and how to integrate that technology. So that is again a requirement at the part of the faculty to fulfill. So as and when required, the teacher is also comfortable to dismantle that technology and switch to the another mode. So that is a major requirement that need to be fulfilled by the faculty. The last thing that we need to consider as far as our blended classrooms are concerned, interaction. How you are going to plan your interactions. There will be a combination of formal as well as informal discussions. Informal discussions, when will it happen? When the students will work in team and group, there are chances that student indulge themselves into informal discussion. So as a teacher, up to what extent you allow your students to have informal discussions? On an online platform, when you are going to create an interactive experiences for your students? So all these things need to be considered in case of blended learning. How to blend effectively? It means there are three important things that we need to consider is, the very first is the context of teaching. Context of teaching means the readiness of your stakeholders. So I cannot force my student to bring laptop if my student do not have laptop. So the kind of resources my students have, those kind of resources need to be the part of my teaching. So readiness of stakeholder means in terms of context, I need to consider that whether the smartphone is available with my student, laptop is available with my student, how many students are able to access internet. So all these kind of things I need to consider. So nation-wise, there are policies set up by the government also that what kind of educational resources are available and what are the different resources that are available for free to use by the faculty as well as to the student. So that kind of readiness need to be there at the part of the faculty. Finance at institute level, is your institute is willing to spend on those resources? So what kind of platform is available at your institute level by which it is possible for you to create a blended experience? Another important thing we need to consider is commitment. It is not only the commitment of the teacher, but it is also the commitment of the learner. So learner need to be disciplined enough. They must be interested in e-learning. Their commitment and regularity towards the work need to be very high. So that kind of skills also need to be developed at the part of the student. Institute role. The institute major role is to support teacher as well as to the faculty. So technical facility, assistant, resources need to be provided to the faculty. And for the students also, such kind of learning spaces need to be created where it is possible for them to interact with each other. Most specifically, the content and the culture. The content is available in abundance. At institute level, we need to map that content first. Say at institute level, when I'm performing my course planning, I need to map my subject with the content available at various My request to the participants to kindly switch off your audio system. So in terms of blended learning, at institute level, we need to map our content first. So whatever subject is being assigned to you, for that particular subject, you need to look into what are the different resources available for this particular subject, and what are the different resources which provide information according to the level of students we have at institute level. If 40% of the content is available at internet on different platforms, the faculty need not to prepare that content again and again. So select the content, tailor the content, use the content, then evaluate your student, and then again supplement if it is required at the part of the student. In a country like us, the culture also plays an important role. So when it comes to a blended learning, and we are using many applications of blended learning, we need to consider that for this particular nation, where the parents are not much aware about the advancement in terms of different educational technology, the students are not much comfortable with the use of technology in some of the locations in our country. And in those areas particularly, we need to design capacity building programs for the student, for the teacher, as well as to the family members. Intensity, when it comes to a blended learning environment, we need to consider the intensity of adoption also. So we need blended packages to whom we adapt fully. Maybe in an initial phase, we need to introduce technology partially, but once the culture is being developed among students as well as among the faculty, the institute need to shift to that particular technology. So we need to evaluate that what suits us in terms of technology and what to our students. So we need hybrid entities. For teaching, we need human as well as non-human element. Specifically for immature learners, for students, we need both kind of experiences to be created. So we need to evaluate that who we are and how we will use it as per our curriculum. So a very famous model that is conceive, develop, implement, and then operate. So after adopting any platform, after adopting any technology, a faculty need to evaluate it. You need to conclude what are the effects of the integration of technology on their on your teaching learning activities. So accordingly, you need to operate further. The third important thing that we need to consider is impact. This impact is impact on student learning. It means the evaluation is required in blended classrooms. What kind of achievement in terms of learning outcomes my students are able to achieve, and the level of student engagement with the technology. So if a recorded video lecture is being provided to the student, how many times the student watch that video? So what are the click moments for that particular video? How many students participates in different quizzes? How many students are really the active participants of the different online platforms that have been developed by the institutes? Many of the good institutes in India introduce LMS facility, and on their LMS facility, students are not actively participating. It means the institute need to re-evaluate their policy so that it is possible for them to integrate technology fully to achieve this blended kind of an approach. So readiness, intensity of adoption, and impact, that need to be considered when it comes to blend effectively the synchronous as well as asynchronous learning. The one thing that we need to consider is blended learning is not mixed mode of teaching. It is not hybrid learning. It is not technology mediated or enhanced learning. So when I said blended learning, it is a full-fledged approach that I am going to use for my class student. Started from the delivery of the instruction up to the evaluation of my student. So it is not simply the mixed mode of teaching or hybrid kind of a teaching, a proper model need to be adopted by the faculty. So a framework under which we are able to adopt different models of blended learning is considered as complex adaptive blended learning. According to this particular model, there are six main pillars in any institute. The first is the learner, second is the teacher, third is the content, fourth is the technology, fifth is learning support, and sixth is the role of institute. As per this diagram, you come to know that all these systems are working within themselves and they are also interacting with each other. When we said that the blended learning is not a mixed mode of learning, it is not hybrid learning, and blended learning is not technology mediated learning, it means I need to select delivery methods that are in line with the learning needs and the available resources. So it is not that I am using a simple YouTube video to my class student, or on the sake of blended learning, I am simply delivering the content with the help of NAPTEL recorded lectures. So that is not blended learning. Blended learning means the teacher need to plan a whole approach. So we know, as we know, that a learning is a dynamic process. So these subsystems act within themselves and upon one another in a dynamic and non-linear fashion. So every subsystem has its own internal factors also, and these systems has their internal forces also under which we are interacting with each other. As far as learners are concerned, in blended learning approach, learners are developing new kind of skills that help them to transfer from passive participants of learning to an active participant. Before going into the details, I would like to show you the lesson plan for blended learning. So for example, blended, as we earlier said, that blended learning is not simply the integration of a technology. So I need to create a whole lesson plan for my blended classroom, where in a class or lesson plan itself, I need to identify what is the entering behavior requirement at the part of the student, what specific objective I'm going to achieve in this particular class, what, according to the different phases of my lecture, how I am going to perform different activities in my classroom. So the simple approach that is used by me is, I divide my lecture into three different parts, that is introductory lecture, developmental phase of my lecture, and conclusion phase of my lecture. In an introductory phase, I will observe and, if required, intervene. There is a discussion on the concept of sampling, term use and sampling, and the requirement is discussion based sitting arrangement. So before going to this class, I need to create an online classroom for my student. So on Google Classroom, I will create a class for my class student where I will provide content for this particular unit. I will provide video recorded lectures to my student. I will organize one quiz to my student also. Once the student undergo that content and listen to those video recorded lectures, the student will come to the class and there is a discussion of around 10 minutes where they will sit into groups and interact with each other and try to polish the information that they have learned in their own time. So, after coming to the class, the student will discuss about the concept, term used, and what they mean by sampling. The content is already provided by me to my student. During the discussion, I observe that many of the students are not well aware about the concept or the terms that is used in a sampling. I need to introduce a teaching strategy, that is muddiest point. So I simply ask my class students that what is the most complex point in that particular unit. So as per their answer, I will plan direct instruction for 10 minutes. In the developmental phase of the lecture, I will summarize the key points that they are able to collect with the discussion. When I'm summarizing the whole information, my students are taking notes. The requirements are PowerPoint presentation, internet connectivity to provide additional reference material to my student. So this activity will go on for 7 minutes. Then development with an individual student. The student will perform activity sitting in group and 20 minutes will be given to the activity. The activity that is being given by me to my class student is, after reading this unit, sampling in the subject of research methodology, you must be able to apply appropriate sampling technique according to the problem defined by you. It means when the student comes to my class, he or she will not only remember the content, but at the same time, his understanding and application will be developed. Once they enter into the class, what activity they need to perform, they need to write a research problem, they need to write research objectives, the hypothesis, and then according to the problem, what kind of a data need to be collected and how to go for a sampling. So student will select an appropriate sampling technique, perform this activity sitting into a group, helping each other, and for 20 minutes they will perform this activity. And then conclusions. When it comes to conclusions, it providing highlights and giving video references. So in the class itself, I will summarize the whole information. Whatever activity performed by the students, from that activity only, I will provide the kind of approach that they need to take care of to perform this kind of activities in future. So peer review will be there. Each student will will check the activity performed by the other student and then provide their valuable comments to the candidate. So in a classroom setup, it is possible for me to provide a direct instruction. So when it comes to a blended classroom, in this particular classroom, we use Google Classroom to announce the activity to the student, to transfer content to the student. YouTube links were provided to the student as far as video recorded lectures are concerned. To check their entry behavior, a quiz was planned by the faculty. So based on that only, an activity is also designed and informed to them well before they enter in my class. So that is a kind of approach that we need to use in a blended classroom situation. So it is not simply the integration of a technology. The teacher need to develop the whole scenario of a classroom situation, that how my class is going to proceed. So what we need for a blended learning is a trained faculty, quality students, learning space, flexibility, and technology. So blended learning will help us to fulfill the requirement of a social environment in various teaching learning practices. So according to this particular theory, the knowledge arises through a process of active construction. So active learning is required. So when I'm providing direct instructions to my student, I need to use individual active learning strategy so that it is possible for me to engage my learner. But when it comes to the students working in group or students working in team collaboratively or cooperatively, that need to be decided by the teacher only. So the kind of learning communities that we are going to create in a classroom, blended classroom, is learning community, focusing on learning together, sharing and developing relationship. Once the relationship have been developed, the teacher need to design activity where the students will sit together and practice. So those practices are professional practices. So community of practice is to be developed in the next step. Once the abilities have been developed among the students, then community of inquiry is required. So focusing on inquiring about an issue or an area. The minimum requirement of a blended learning classroom is a knowledge community. So the focus of the student must be for the development of the knowledge. If the students do not come prepared in my class, in my blended class, my students are failed to produce. Because in a blended classroom, the formative assessment parameter can be easily designed by the faculty within the class timing itself. So the knowledge is a basic requirement for the students to develop as far as blended classrooms are concerned. At the part of the faculty, what are the different requirements of e-communities? The very first requirement is to know your students' netiquette rules. It is my personal experience, when I'm floating module number 3 under AICT NINET policy, many of the faculty members, after the submission date of an assignment, email me, text me, phone me that I need to increase the number of chances for that particular attempt. So as a teacher on that platform, we need to strict enough that if I said multiple submissions are not required, it means multiple submissions are not required. If we fix the schedule of the activity that you have to submit this activity before Friday, so within that time period only I'm going to evaluate that activity. So fixed rules need to be there as far as different e-communities are concerned. So most of the activities need to be graded one that will force the student to perform that activity. When it comes to integration of technology, depending upon the level of the students, we need to select appropriate resources. With the help of creating live interactions for our students, we need to, it is possible for us to develop good interpersonal relations with the student, create a learning space. At institute level, we need to design such spaces where it is possible for us to move our student from traditional setup to those flexible structures. Let them work. The major requirement of blended learning is I'm not going to spoon feed the information. I'm providing the content according to the level of the students. If my students are not capable to do that, I need to change my instructional strategy. I will not go by blended approach. So let them work. If it is desired by a student or required at his or her part, we need to supplement that information. So this is about blended learning. So there are many models of blended learning the participant can select. So there are two main approaches, in-class approach and out-of-class approach. Under in-class approach, there is station rotation model, lab rotation model, and individual rotation model. As we earlier discussed, in a station rotation model, the teacher will fix the schedule that when I am going to give direct instruction to my student. After having the direct instructions, my student will work on any online platform that is being decided by the faculty, and there must be chances given to the students to interact within the group. So that model is considered as station rotation model. As and when desired by the faculty, the teacher can also manipulate the model. So teacher can organize a discussion first. After discussion, teacher can organize a instruction, and then the students will work on an online activity. Individual rotation model means first the teacher will provide direct instruction to each and every candidate. Once the students are performing that activity in class, the teacher will observe the students, and if required, the teacher will intervene. Then students work online most of the time with the content. So once the content is developed online and prepared by the student will practice that content by his or her own. So individually, every student will work on a group station, and after that, they will perform the activity individually only. Lab rotation model, it is not a simple computer lab. Lab rotation model is any working station which provide asynchronous experiences to the learner. So that is considered as a lab in this particular case. Again, in this case, a schedule is being fixed by the teacher that when the student will work in a class or when the student will go to a lab. So teacher will provide direct instructions collectively to the students, and collectively they will move forward to the learning spaces. I am not going to brief about flipped classroom. This particular session will be engaged by some other faculty. So flipped classroom is again an approach that is covered under in-class approaches of blended learning. there are certain different modules that the teacher can use out of the class also. This is Ekati model, flex model, and enriched model. As far as Lekati model, A Lekati model is concerned, it is also considered as self-blend model. So in this particular model, the teacher is always available online. The students can work at their home, the student can work at institute, or student can work in their personal spaces also. As and when desired, the teacher can contact with the student, and even the students can also contact with the teacher. Flex model is the most adopted model as far as Indian technical education systems are concerned. In a flexed model, there is a central learning laboratory facility provided to the student, where the students can help each other, interact with each other, and prepare for that content. Teacher will intervene and assess the student performance. There is a social area also provided to the student to interact with each other separately. Students will perform all kind of activities by their own, and then at the end, when the students are capable enough, they will perform individually. Enriched virtual model, most of the content will be available online. While sitting offline, we are referring to that particular content. So this is a blended classroom, a very simple approach that can be utilized for a blended classroom. So when it comes to designing a blended classroom, always go by a smaller section of your content. So after getting a command on that particular content, move forward with a different kind of instructional strategy and a different instructional blended model. So friends, this is all about blended learning and what are the different things that we need to consider when it comes to developing, clubbing blended as well as synchronous as well as asynchronous learning. So if there is any question, you can write it in a chat box. As far as the PowerPoint presentations of these two sessions are concerned, I will pass this PowerPoint presentation to Manisha, and Manisha will forward to all the participants. So Manisha, can you do this for me?
Yes, ma'am, I'll do that, ma'am.
Okay. So the PowerPoint presentations will be provided to all of you, and the references from where I have prepared these PowerPoint presentations, those references are provided in the slides also. For the supplemented information, you can go to those links. So if there is any question, you are most welcome. So thank you very much, all the participants. In my next class, that will be on Thursday, on rubrics. Before going into the details of rubric, there will be a small quiz for all of you. So after evaluating that quiz only, we will go for discussion over the rubric. One participant asked, we have to take help of hybrid learning for blended learning. Very right, sir. We for the integration of technology, we need to integrate such kind of experiences for our learning. So thank you very much, all the participants. Manisha, is there any question available with you?
No, ma'am.
So thank you.
Peer reviewed assignment platform. If you could name any peer reviewed assignment platform.
So, sir, as far as the different sessions are concerned, Dr. Srinivasa sir is going to discuss many of the platforms with you where it is possible for you to have a peered kind of evaluation for your students. So there are a number of platforms available. I think Srinivasa sir will inform you all about those platforms also.
There is a peer review platform.
Yes. So I'm not going into that detail. So thank you very much, all the participants, for your patience listening. One participant said, ma'am, One participant said, how much do you think is achievable in technical education system practically? Sir, as far as blended classrooms are concerned, it is very much possible for the faculty to create such kind of experiences because they are not totally technology dependent. It's a integration of face-to-face as well as technology teaching. So open educational resources are available nowadays. So teacher can simply plan for the blended classroom. But the teacher need to put maximum effort to plan for a lesson. So it is practically possible.
There are another one or two questions, madam. Which model you suggest in the pandemic situation?
Sir, in this particular situation, the only option with the faculty members is enriched virtual model.
Yeah, bilkul.
I think so. Yes.
So, okay, madam. Thank you for your wonderful session, and it was really informative. So, again, we will see you back on one more session on the rubrics and evaluation related things on, I think, day after
yes,
tomorrow.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank
yes.
you. Thank
we
you.
Will meet again.
Thank
yes.
you, madam.
Thank you very much. So, thank you very much, all the participants.